Hello and good morning. It's 8:30 a.m. and you're tuning in to WRSU-FM New Brunswick. And this is Scientifically Ever After, a show that brings literature to life by looking at the science behind them. Each week we take a piece of literature and put a new spin on it, a different perspective that observes it through the lens of science, from the social, cognitive, and biological sciences to even the more mathematical forms of reasoning and logic. And this week, I'm so excited to tell you that we're covering A Wrinkle in Time by Madeleine L'Engle. So come aboard with us on this journey through time travel, technology, and much, much more. Okay, I have a confession to make. It took me Oprah Winfrey, Reese Witherspoon, and Mindy Kaling, who played Mrs. Witch, Mrs. Watsit, and Mrs. Who in the movie, to discover this book and how truly wonderful it is. It would have definitely added a lot more magic and sci-fi wonder to my childhood that was otherwise filled with Junabee Jones and Enid Blyton stories. Probably a lot more than necessary. Before we take a stroll through A Wrinkle in Time, I'd like to read a quote from an appreciation of the book that was written by the New York Times columnist Anna Quindlen. "The most memorable books from our childhood are those that make us feel less alone and convince us that our foibles and quirks are both individual as a fingerprint and as universal as an open hand. On the surface, this is a book about three children who fight an evil force threatening their planet. But it really is about a primal battle all human beings face to respect, defend, and love themselves." We find our protagonist Meng Murray to feel quite alone in the beginning. She's 13 years old and her friends and teachers see her as stubborn and not very smart. She thinks of herself to be unattractive with her glasses, braces, and frizzy flyaway hair. And to top that off, her physicist father, Mr. Murray, has been missing for 5 years, ever since he discovered a new planet using a concept called a tesseract to time travel. One stormy evening, a mysterious stranger bundled up in clothes and scarves arrives at their door. It's Mrs. Watsit. As the story goes on, we realize Mrs. Watsit has come to recruit Meg, as well as her brother Charles Wallace, on a mission across the universe to save their father. Meg's classmate Calvin O'Keefe joins in on the adventure too. Mrs. Watsit seems to be a quite playful and often eccentric old woman who has two other companions, Mrs. Who and Mrs. Witch. Mrs. Who often finds it difficult to verbalize it in her own words, and you can see her quoting everything from Latin and Portuguese to Shakespeare and Pascal. Mrs. Witch appears to be the wisest of them all. She has been around for millennia and has a vast knowledge of the universe and time travel. The three women seem like celestial beings, almost fairy godmothers to Meg and her team. So Mrs. Watsit, Mrs. Who, and Mrs. Witch talk to the trio about traveling by way of tesseracts. Here's the thing, though. Even with the help of tesseracts, getting there won't be easy. The universe is threatened by a physical manifestation of evil called the Dark Thing. The Dark Thing has already engulfed planets and stars, including the planet Camazotz, where Mr. Murray is being kept prisoner. If you haven't read the book or seen the movie, you're probably thinking, what on earth is a tesseract? We'll be getting into that shortly, and how they use it for time travel. The author, Madeline Lengel, was inspired to write this story after reading about quantum physics and what Einstein wrote about time and the theory of relativity. Einstein showed that time is relative and is affected by motion. A clock on a satellite that's orbiting around the Earth ticks faster than one remaining on the ground. But perhaps one of Einstein's more revolutionary ideas was this idea that space and time are not separate entities, but instead different aspects of space-time, the fabric of our universe. In physics, space-time is any mathematical model that fuses the three dimensions of space, length, breadth, and height, and the one dimension of time into a single four-dimensional continuum. He called time an illusion, not rejecting the existence of time, but rather rejecting the difference between past, present, and future. He believed in the fabric of time, the block universe conception of space-time. We see this idea of time being like a fabric in the book, when Mrs. Hu explained it to them with the folds of her skirt. Imagine a small insect moving from one section of the skirt to another. It would be quite a long walk for it if it had to walk straight across. Mrs. Hu brought her hands together, still holding the skirt. Without that long distance, the insect could move from one point to another, cutting down on the time it took to get there. It's a shortcut. And to time travel, or rather, taking a shortcut cut across space-time, we need to use the tesseract. In the book, Meg's brother, Charles Wallace, explains that the first dimension is a line, and the second dimension is a square, the third a cube, and the fourth time. And that brings us to the fifth dimension, which is a tesseract. Essentially, a tesseract is a four-dimensional cube, and using this concept allows you to apparently tesser, or wrinkle, in time. And if you want to check this out further, Brown University's math department actually created a mathematical explanation for the tesseract, complete with diagrams. So now, if you add the fifth dimension to the other four dimensions, you can travel through space without having to go the long way around. In other words, to put into Euclid, or old-fashioned geometry, in this case, a straight line is not the shortest distance between two points. Time travel is made possible through this fifth dimension. It's sort of like a wormhole that allows our characters to move through space-time. Now, I'll need to admit that our author, Lengel, takes a bit of an artistic approach on this idea. Since real-life mathematicians define tesseracts as a shape with four spatial dimensions, the first would be length, and the second would be breadth, and the third height, the fourth would be time, and we can't see time, but we can still move through it every day. But Lengel is not wrong to suggest that the fifth dimension exists. In superstring theory, there are as many as six dimensions that are curled into four accepted dimensions. And proof of this seemed to lie in gravitational waves. Since gravity is present in all dimensions, it can be detected in other dimensions. At a time where we didn't have any physical proof of gravitational waves, and where time travel theories didn't seem plausible, Madeline Lengel really deserves credit for piecing together a really convincing time travel method with the tesseract. This concept of tesseracts has appeared in pop culture, in recent pop culture as well, from the Marvel Universe to the movie Interstellar. But of course, it's nothing if you don't believe in it. This book talks a lot about believing, particularly in yourself, and believe it or not, there's science behind that too. Before we dig right in, here's a song from the movie called Believe, sung by Demi Lovato and featuring DJ Khaled. I wonder if he'll say another one like he usually does.
Ooh, yeah. Another one.
Some people stay, some people move. Tough times don't last, but tough people do. As long as you've got hope, you'll find your way. long as there is love, I can make it anywhere I go. If I follow my dreams, I'll end up building a yellow brick road. I will. Yeah, I am, no fear, no fear. Living my best life, I am wearing a crown that's only fit for a queen. I'm glorious, victorious, a warrior.
Let's rise. Succeed, you must believe.
We the best music.
I believe.
Another one.
A wrinkle in time.
I believe the power of belief is incredibly underrated. Sure, we are biological beings. We respond naturally to stimuli in our environment, from the physical world to the visceral world of chemicals and cells. But there's something that results from our consciousness that may seem more complex to comprehend: the mind. You may have heard of the placebo effect, where our thoughts and expectations seem to control what happens to our bodies. A placebo is a substance with no known medical effects, like a sugar pill, for instance. It's a fake treatment that, in some cases, can produce very real therapeutic results. Even placebo surgery, in fact, can be more effective than you think. A trial from Finland that was published by the New England Journal of Medicine in 2014 had candidates for knee surgery. They all had tears in their meniscus and had debilitating pain. And when they arrived in the operating room, the study surgeons performed either a repair of the torn cartilage or a charade. Incisions were made and closed with no other intervention. And would you believe it? The subjects who underwent the fake procedure experienced just as much improvement in pain and activity as those whose meniscus was actually repaired. There were similar results from placebo migraine treatment to even heart procedures. There are also studies that take the placebo effect even further and show you're more likely to perform better on tests if you're more assuring of yourself and believe you know the answers as opposed to just studying for them. Many researchers are, however, still skeptical of this effect, and we still don't really know the how and why of it. A convincing argument is that placebos cause changes in our neurobiological signaling pathways. Where, let's say you're a patient who's experiencing body pain. You're prescribed a pill, and you don't know you're taking a sugar pill. It's the expectation of the benefits you'll get after you take the pill that activates reward pathways in your brain. This, in turn, releases substances called endorphins. Endorphins are neurotransmitters that are chemically similar to opiates like morphine. Like morphine, these endorphins bind to opioid receptors and cause pain relief. So, in response to the positive expectations of your treatment, your brain gets flooded with its own supply of natural painkillers. Genetics and even your imagination seem to play a role into this effect as well. Next up, I'm adding a different and relevant perspective that the Wrinkle in Time movie brings in. The director of the 2018 film, Ava DuVernay, remixes it to include the concept of Afrofuturism. The movie casts many people of color into the lead. It draws in the discussion of inclusion, similar to how we see Meg feel less alone and soon discover her voice and the power of love as the story progresses. Afrofuturism has given a voice to those who, for the longest, were invisible in science fiction and fantasy spaces. It transforms the conventional idea of science fiction into a concept that combines traditional African heritage, magical realism, and a socioeconomic exploration of the Black experience into something entirely new and unique. One contemporary artist who's known for her use of sci-fi and identity into her work is Janelle Monáe. One of the concept albums she released, Metropolis, was particularly inspired by the 1927 film of the same name. In Metropolis, we see Monet's alter ego, Cindy Mayweather, who is an android who becomes aware of the unfairness she and her fellow robots suffer at the hands of the ruling humans, and so is sent back in time to free the citizens of Metropolis. In the song I'm about to play in a second, Tightrope, Monáe uses dance as a form of rebellious freedom. So here it is, Tightrope.
Okay.
Afrofuturism is a cultural aesthetic, philosophy of science and of history that explores the developing intersection of African or African diaspora culture with technology. The term was coined by culture critic Mark Derry in 1994 in his essay Black to the Future. It was to point out the lack of African-American writers and stories in fiction. Looking at works like Black Panther, historical events are re-examined, and we can almost imagine a world that was not impacted by colonialism or exploitation. It allows African-Americans to see themselves in a future despite a distressing past and present. There are also retro-Afrofuturist artists as well who use the genre to reimagine the past. Take artist Tim Fielder, for instance, in the graphic novel Maddie's Rocket. Tim Fielder imagines a Jim Crow-era heroine named Maddie who flies rocket ships and fights back against hate groups and aliens with her trusty rifle. This is an interesting mix of science fiction and social justice that fills in the voids that hurt so many. Ultimately, Afrofuturism shows us a future filled with hope. This idea that in order to overcome the current ways of inequality in society, there needs to be futures where those problems are solved. That was a short clip from Sun Ra's Somewhere in Space. He was a legendary pioneer of Afrofuturism. And now for a final discussion of the day. Let's talk about it. Yup, it. The bad guy of A Wrinkle in Time. It is perceived to be a giant brain that controls all of the people of Kamazots. At Kamazots, everything seems highly regimented. Even when Meg sees children playing at the Kamazots, the boys playing ball, the girls skipping ropes, all of them are doing so exactly in the same rhythm. In the town, everyone is identical, down to their very actions. Their greatest fear is to be different, to stand out in any way. It symbolizes an entity that tries to control the individual's thoughts and decisions. In the book, the first instance we see it is embodied in this man with red eyes. His eyes seem to emit a bright red light has the ability to bear into an individual's soul and control his or her mind. Now, this could certainly be possible through something called optogenetics. Optogenetics is a powerful technology that enables researchers to control genetically modified neurons with a brief pulse of light. To artificially turn on a memory, researchers set out to identify the neurons that are activated when a mouse is making a new memory. They focused on a part of the brain called hippocampus, which is known for its role in learning and memory. Then they inserted a gene that codes for a light-sensitive protein into the hippocampal neurons, enabling them to use light to control the neurons. With the light-sensitive proteins in place, the researchers gave the mouse a new memory. You can control minds through the power of light. In fact, over the last several years, optogenetics has provided powerful insights into the neural underpinnings of brain disorders like depression, anxiety, and schizophrenia. Now, coming back to the It's idea of wanting to control everyone and make them all the same, here's a passage from the book that really struck me. It's where Mrs. Watsit gives the three children, Meg, Charles Wallace, and Calvin, gifts before they leave to the planet of Kamazots to fight the evil force of it and save Meg's father. She looked steadily at each of the three children. "You will need help," Mrs. Watson told them. "But all I am allowed to give you is a little talisman. Calvin, your great gift is your ability to communicate with all kinds of people. So for you, I will strengthen this gift. Meg, I give you your faults.
My faults? Meg cried. Your faults.
But I'm always trying to get rid of my faults.
Yes, Mrs. Watsit said. However, I think you'll find they'll come in very handy on Camazotz. Charles Wallace, to you, I can only give the resilience of your childhood.
Meg's faults are things she needs to overcome the forces of evil. This idea of the balance between looking at our individual differences as advantages, like in the case of genetic variation, as well as uniting with each other through our similarities, is interesting. The writer Lengel is critical of the human forces of standardization and conformity that could potentially inhibit creativity. At the same time, she says, What a child doesn't realize until he's grown is that in responding to fantasy, fairy tale, and myth, is responding to what Eric Fromm calls one universal language, the one and only language in the world that cuts across all barriers of time, place, and culture. Many Newbery books are from this realm, beginning with Dr. Doolittle, books on Hindu myth, Chinese folklore, the life of Buddha, tales of American Indians, books that lead our children beyond all boundaries and into the one language of all mankind. It's interesting that on the opposite end of our division and inequality, there's a force that unifies us all. Call it what you wish, the universal language, imagination, love, humanity, the force. May the force be with you today. And with that, I'm afraid it's time to leave for now. If you liked today's show, don't forget to let me know on Twitter, Facebook, or at WRSU.org. Next week's spring break, so I may need to miss you next Tuesday, but I'm making up for it with an even more exciting scientific rendition of Marley and Me, Life and Love with the World's Worst Dog, a memoir by journalist John Grogan. Soft and cuddly Labrador Retrievers and other dogs, as well as some surprising neuroscience, are coming your way next time. Until then, I'm leaving you with another song by Janelle Monáe called Electric Lady. As always, thank you so much for tuning in to Scientifically Ever After. This is your host, Hannah, signing out.
Lady, you're a star. showing love while the boys be catching feelings. Once you see her face, her eyes you'll remember, and she'll have you falling harder than a Sunday in September. Whether in Savannah, Kansas, or in Atlanta, she'll walk in any room, have you raising up your antennas. She can fly you straight to the moon or to the ghettos, wearing teeny shoes or in flats or in stilettos. Illuminating all that she touches, I'm the sparrow. A modern day Joan of Arc, call me a pharaoh. Classy, sassy, put you in a razzle dazzle. Her magnetic energy will have you coming home like Lassie, singing ooh, shock it, break it.